Hey everybody, and welcome back to our channel. Today we have a very special guest with us, someone who's not only an expert in the legal field, but also a guiding light for creatives, entrepreneurs, and artists alike. I'm thrilled to introduce Melissa Kofod with Sage Business Counsel, a renowned attorney known for her deep expertise in intellectual property, business law, and tax strategies. Melissa has a diverse background working with photographers, musicians, startup founders, and many more in the creative and business spheres. Her insights have helped countless individuals and businesses navigate the complex legal landscape, ensuring their work and innovations are protected and they flourish. In this interview, we'll dive into some crucial topics from protecting your creative work to the legal essentials of starting a business and much more. Whether you're a budding artist, a musician with dreams of hitting it big, or an entrepreneur at the start of your journey, Melissa's knowledge and experience are invaluable. As always, though, if you do have any questions as we go throughout the video, whether they're for myself or for Melissa, be sure that you comment those below and we'll be more than happy to get you the answers. We're here to clarify and make sure that you have the best information possible. So without further ado, let's get into our conversation with Melissa Kofod and uncover some vital legal tips and strategies that you can help you succeed in your creative and business endeavors. Remember to hit the like button and subscribe if you haven't already, but let's jump right in. Welcome, Melissa. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you, Brew, for having me. It's been a long time. It's very nice to see your face after that long pandemic break.
We were in a break there for a hot minute. And the world changes, it seems, on a daily basis these days. We were talking a little bit about real estate before, but I'm excited to hear about what the legal side, since you're now the expert to go to in that area.
Yeah. I've been practicing law for over 10 years. And, you know, I've been an entrepreneur. I've had my real estate license for over 20 years. So I do a lot of work with people in the real estate field, mostly commercial, mm-hmm. and do a lot of work with entrepreneurs and also focus on a lot of entertainment law. So I am a transactional attorney. I do not go to court. And I think that, you know, the challenge is to let people know that they can spend money up front on someone like me to structure their business, ensure their regulatory compliance. Or they can wait till they have a pain point that's obvious and hire a litigator and go through court, which realistically is going to cost them over a year and over six figures. I think people don't realize how costly litigation can be and how disruptive to their business and their lives it can be. So my job is to ensure that my clients, have smooth sailings from the get-go.
Well, you actually hit my first two questions were, what are your background and what are some of the challenges? So that rolls us along. And for those folks that are out there watching, we're going to hit these in fairly fast succession. So be sure that you keep up and that you stay tuned to the end to hear some of the most critical steps. And, you know, you talked a little bit about some of the most common legal challenges for photographers, artists, and musicians, I guess, in sort of, you know, that they pop up. What would be some of those types of challenges they might face?
I think the number one challenge I have with artists is that they don't view themselves as a business. And they don't view their output as their business product. So they also end up becoming prey to predatory contracts. And it's really essential that they understand what's in the contracts. And I still don't understand this. I never have. But contracts are always written in something called legalese that we attorneys like, well, most attorneys like to use. And what could be said in one simple sentence, we write three pages about, that's incredibly confusing. So they're really hard to understand, they're really complex, and it's essential to get an experienced attorney involved in at least reviewing the contract and explaining to you what you're getting into so that you can decide, you can make an informed decision whether you want to execute on that contract. And a lot of them are very predatory. So you can have an attorney that has experience in that area negotiate the contract for you, because there's no reason that these contracts can't be win-win. And that's really my goal, is to create a win-win for my client, for the entity creating the contract, so they can have an extended and fruitful relationship. Essentially, I want to make sure that both people get the bag.
That's a great way to look at it too. You said, especially thinking about it as a business. I find that a lot with real estate agents, oddly enough, is they don't look at it as a business. They think of it as a hobby. And you know, for somebody who's starting a new business, what are those crucial first legal steps that they really should not overlook?
There's entity formation, entity selection. So making sure that you have a good CPA involved. I'm not a licensed CPA. I'm not a tax advisor. Hell, I don't even do my own taxes. So yeah, I can give you the options for your entity formation. You could be a sole proprietorship, an LLC, a corporation. And then there's the how are you going to tax? Because people think S-Corp is a corporate structure. It's not. It's just a taxation structure. So an LLC can be taxed as an S-Corp. And you really need to have somebody to explain to you the concept of pass-through taxation. So that you don't end up being double taxed on your corporation's revenues. I don't personally think that people, and this is not to be construed as legal advice, this does not create an attorney-client relationship. This is my personal belief. I don't think until you get to around $70,000 in revenue, if you're a sole proprietor, that you really need to elect as an S-Corp. But that's a question for your tax professional. And then setting up, you know, making sure you get your EIN, making sure that you're registered with the state that you're in. And every industry has its own regulations, and you need to know about those. There are even updated regulations. I just posted about this online, and I'm dropping a video about this today. But FinSec is now not only requiring corporations to file every year, they're now requiring LLCs to file. And entrepreneurs don't have the time to keep up with these sort of regulatory changes that happen so quickly. So, you know, they don't know that if you have a dormant LLC and you don't dissolve that dormant LLC by January 1st, you're going to be subject to fines if you don't file by January 25th on the FinSec system, which, by the way, is not created yet.
Well, that's going to be a challenge to file, isn't it?
It's going to be a challenge to file. And these regulations are popping up all the time, and we stay abreast of these. That's my job. My job is to stay educated. My job is to make sure that you focus on running your business, and I focus on making sure that you are compliant. And I also do business strategy too for clients as an entrepreneur, a former, I owned bars, I owned restaurants, I have a marketing company, a law firm of my own. In addition to being of counsel as Sage. So, you know, as an experienced entrepreneur and attorney, knowing the ins and outs of what you're going to deal with and helping guide you along the way. And it's not just a one-time deal. It's not just, hey, I'm going to set up my business formation and see you later, lawyer. I will hold the hands of my clients throughout their process if that's what they need. And ensure that throughout their process that all of their contracts are set up properly, and that I protect them from liability, because I do not want to see them in court. I hate court.
Now, do you also work with like intellectual property and those types of, you know, establishing protection of intellectual
property? Absolutely. Absolutely. I think that's a core part of business and entertainment law. I do not do patents, but intellectual property really encompasses trademarks, copyrights, patents, and then the trade secrets and trade dress. Trademarks are really important. That's like the Nike swoosh. It's what identifies your business. But copyrights are going to be your content. So for realtors, it's really important, because if they're repurposing those photographs that some other photographer took, they're committing a copyright violation. That photography studio, that photographer, they own the copyright. You can't just use that without either licensing it from the copyright holder or getting it created yourself with a work for hire agreement for a photographer. So I see a lot of missteps with realtors in that area. Also the copy that's written by somebody, your copy that you're putting in your webcast, you know, some of the guides that you put out, those are your intellectual property. And realtors need to be aware of this. I've seen realtors that put out courses to help other realtors. That is their intellectual property, and they should protect it. I'll be really frank. You don't need an attorney. You don't need to hire an attorney to file copyright. You can do it yourself. It's really easy. I'm happy to teach people how. If you find an attorney that says you need to hire me to file your copyright, run. You do need an attorney to file your trademark, or I would suggest an attorney to file your trademark. Patent law is a different beast. That is some science and math stuff. And I became a lawyer because I am not good at science and math.
Well, so you work with all different types of creatives, including like the music industry. Is that correct?
I do. I'm an entertainment and business transactional attorney.
Well, if you had two pieces of advice to give a musician or emerging artist, what would that be?
Oh, man. Don't infringe on somebody else's intellectual property, because clearing tracks is expensive. And don't sign contracts without your attorney reviewing them. I just executed a sync licensing deal for a client, and the original deal was really predatory, but we ended up being able to just mutually negotiate out a win-win that both the licensing company and the artists are very happy with, and they're both going to make a lot of money with. So those are my two greatest pieces of advice. My third is get out there.
Getting out there, I think, is critical with everything, is it not?
It is. Get yourself out there. Just do it.
But, you know, and it's interesting because we have all of these channels like YouTube and stuff like that, and they pick up on your creative, your whether it's a musical or an audible or an image copyright infringement. They pick them up just like that, and they can just...
Oh, yeah. I created a service. I used a web developer. Mm-hmm. And I created a proprietary service that scrapes the internet just for my clients' copyright or trademark violations. And most people will, with copyright violations, send a DMCA takedown notice. And DMCA is the Digital Millennium Copyright Act. And you can get your stuff taken off the internet. That's not really a huge problem. But what they don't realize is there's an opportunity to make money there. You could also send a DMCA/licensing notice. And say, either take it down or pay me. And I've found that 90% of the time when I reach out to people and say, take it down or pay me, they pay. And my clients make more money. So
that's great.
You know, there's a way to not jump the gun, not put the cart before the horse, and really think it through in a strategic manner. So I like to strategize with my clients and suggest that they really think about what their ultimate goals are.
Well, what do you see with your clients that are in these industries? What are some of their most common misconceptions about the legal issues that come up in the creative and business sector?
Okay. So one of them is, I don't need a lawyer for the formation of this business. I can do it myself. It's easy. And then a couple years later, or for the sale of a business, mm-hmm. a couple years later, they come to me and they say, I got a problem. I'm in litigation. And I would have cost a fraction of the price. Maybe everything would have cost them. And I'm making out numbers here. I'm not quoting specific numbers, but let's say it would have cost you $10,000 mm-hmm. in the beginning. And you're like, whoo, that's a lot of money. They're financing, you know, we use LawPay. They'll finance you. You don't have to pay all at once. So, but then let's say you didn't do that in the beginning, and you know, a couple years later, you're getting sued because you messed something up. You used Rocket Lawyer or LegalZoom to do your contracts, and something was missed because this is not a one size fits all world. And now you want me to refer you to a litigator, and you're $200,000 out of pocket, and it's been 2.5 years of litigation, and you're pulling out your hair and don't realize that litigation, I mean, especially post-COVID with the courts being slammed, I mean, you can look up to 3 years.
So not only in time, but you're talking about 20x the amount of money, basically, to not do it right the first time.
Yeah, and there are ways that you can work, especially as an artist, with an attorney in the beginning. Some attorneys are just going to draft your contracts, and that's fine. That's great. They're one-off attorneys. Some attorneys are going to strategize with you and be your business strategist. So with my business clients, with my artists, I love business strategy. It is my passion. I want to help them grow their business, so I will strategize with them. I am sitting down with a client on Friday night. It's part of his package. I don't bill by the minute. I don't bill by the hour. I create flat fee programs because I don't want any surprises for my client. I remember when I had to hire an attorney and I got my first bill, And I said, that email cost me $75? It was a minute. Even as an attorney, I was shocked. Mm-hmm. Because I'd never seen the other side of it. So that's when I decided that it's my ethical obligation as an attorney to fight for my clients, even against my own self-interest. And if I'm billing by the minute or I'm billing by the hour, there's no way that I'm not encouraged to pad the bills. So I just charge a flat fee. And that way, when my client wants to meet up for a beer on a Friday night, or my client wants me to fly up to New York and be on his podcast, I do these things as part of my services to my client. And it might be that I charge you too little for a contract, but I'm not going to go back on my word, because I realized later that it's going to cost me more time than I thought it would. I'm sticking with that flat fee. There are no surprises for my clients. So I offer, for some clients, business strategic advice. And for some clients that I believe in the artistic space, I will shop them and market them and help them build their careers without having to go the route of getting sucked into a major record label deal where they're going to end up potentially owing hundreds of thousands of dollars if they're not an instant hit.
Well, so, I mean, obviously creatives see their business is totally different than a lot of folks do. It sounds like, what should creatives and business owners consider when they are choosing their legal representation?
I think it's gotta be a fit. I mean, you guys see me, I'm in my living room right now. I work remote Thursdays and Fridays. I'm covered in tattoos. I'm still a professional. I dress up for the office. I've got business suits. I don't like wearing them. But I will meet you where you are. I will meet you where you're at. I have international clients as well. So I set some hours aside during the week where they can consult with me during their time zone. So I'm a very flexible attorney. I think a personality fit, a billing fit, clarity is going to be really important. I lived in Mexico for 2 years over COVID. And I'll tell you, it changed me as a person. I was kind of a type A, I don't know if I can say this on your podcast, but a-hole. Typical attorney, go, go, go. And I don't know, something about surfing for 2 years and living in a village with no shoes and no infrastructure changed me. And I'm pretty chill about things. I get the work done, but nothing really makes me angry. I don't freak out. I strategize. And I'm kind to my clients and I'm kind to opposing parties until you need me to be that dragon in Game of Thrones and you scream Dracarys, and then I will scorch the earth for you. I can be that guy, but until then, I think that there's a way to just calmly enter things. I explain things to my clients in plain English. I don't speak in legalese to them. And I'm pretty good at negotiations and I'm very well connected. So keep that in mind when you're hiring an attorney. Like, what do you want? Do you want a connector? Do you just want someone that's going to grind out one contract review for you? Know what you want. Make sure that you look for attorneys. Check and see if they've had any bar disciplinary actions. You can check that out on the Georgia Bar or whatever your local state bar website is. And make sure that they're licensed also in the state that you need the work done in. You know, I'm licensed in multiple states, so that helps for me. But, you can't hire, you can't open a Delaware corporation and have a Georgia licensed attorney do that work for you.
All right. Well, this is a lot of great information. And I know it's a lot to take in. I hope that our viewers are getting some great information out of this. It does wrap up our session though today with Melissa Kofod with Sage Business Counsel. Melissa, thank you so much for sharing your invaluable insights.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Brew, for having me. I just got to give a shout out to Brew. I've never met a more entrepreneurial, heads down agent. And I am stoked for what you've done with your career. I have been around since Ansley was Ansley. And you had that little office there, and I am just super impressed with what you've done. So kudos to you.
Thank you.
You're also just an awesome guy, and you love animals as much as I do, which
probably more than most people, unfortunately.
I do too, which really, gives me your heart. And also, I do have a creatives firm And it's Kofod Creative Counsel. So it's kofodlaw.com. And you can find me on Instagram. I respond to DMs way faster than I do email because I get thousands of emails. Just look at Missy the Don on Instagram and shoot me a DM. I'll respond to that way quicker than I will email.
So that's at Missy the Don for your Instagram.
Yep, Missy the Don.
I meant to ask that. I forgot to do that earlier, so I'm glad that you brought that
up. Oh no, absolutely, absolutely. Holy. And I really appreciate you having me, Brew, and please let's get together and have an actual drink in person soon. I think we're right around the corner from each other.
We are. And really, your knowledge and experience in the legal aspect and the creative and the business world really are truly inspiring and enlightening. And your history with everything that you've done is really fantastic.
Thank you.
For our viewers out there, I really do hope you guys found this valuable and this information valuable as much as we did. Whether you're navigating the complexities of an intellectual property, starting a new business venture, or looking for legal strategies for your creative work, Melissa's advice is a treasure trove of information. Remember, you can reach right out directly to her with the details that are provided to you here in the video. For more personalized guidance, don't forget to check out her Sage Business Counsel website, and as well as her Kofod Business Law.
Yeah, if you just go to Kofod Law, it's Kofod Law, LAW.com. I am not proud of that website, and it is being redesigned by professionals right now. So hit me up on Instagram and don't judge me on that website.
Perfect. All right, so go to the website at Missy the Dime. And before we sign out, do not forget to hit the like button if you enjoyed this interview and subscribe to our channel for more content like this. And don't forget to hit that little bell button to be notified when those new videos come out. We always love hearing from you. We love your thoughts, and please leave those in the comments below. Thank you so much for joining us today. For more insightful conversations and expert interviews, we'll be staying tuned. And until next time, keep innovating, creating, and making your mark in the world.